Hello, and welcome to our introductory quick start tutorial for V-Ray for SketchUp. In this video, we'll go over the basics of using V-Ray Next in SketchUp and how to get productive right away. We'll introduce you to the new user interface, how to quickly get started with your scene, and go over a couple of new features in the latest release. To start, let's head over into SketchUp. I'm going to be using SketchUp version 2019, but you can use earlier versions of SketchUp as well, starting from 2016 onwards. Alright, here I have opened up the project file called 01 Introduction Start. When you have V-Ray for SketchUp installed, you'll notice that it has added four new toolbars to the interface. In this toolbar, you'll find some of the most important V-Ray tools, including the Asset Editor, Render Button, Interactive Render Button, as well as Viewport Rendering. You'll also find the V-Ray Frame Buffer, or VFB for short, which is a window for displaying your renders and gives you access to additional V-Ray tools such as color corrections. Next to that, we have the Lights toolbar, which allows you to create and place V-Ray lights in your scene. To the right, we have the Geometry toolbar, which gives you access to specific V-Ray geometry like the Infinite Ground Plane, Proxies and Fur, and finally, V-Ray Utilities, which allow you to make operations like removing materials or modifying the texture placement for your texture maps. Now let's open up the Asset Editor here by clicking on the V-Ray icon. You can think of the Asset Editor as the command center of V-Ray. Here you can manage everything from your materials and lights to render settings, render elements, and more. Let's start at the top. You'll see here the Asset Editor is separated into five categories for the various assets in your scene, such as materials, lights, geometry, render elements, and textures. To the right, we have the render settings for controlling options such as the resolution of your image. We also have the Render button and a dropdown that we can click and hold to access interactive rendering, cloud rendering, and the option to export a VR scene file. Okay, let's first click on the settings. The first parameter in the render rollout here is the render engine. Here we can choose whether to use our CPU or GPU for rendering our image. Since I have a powerful GPU in my PC, I'm going to select GPU rendering, as it gives me better performance on my machine. Generally, this is one of the first things you'll want to decide on when starting a new project in SketchUp, since some V-Ray features only work with either CPU or GPU. Next, let's enable the interactive toggle so that when we render the scene, we'll get interactive feedback based on any changes we make to the geometry, materials, lights, and so forth in our render. Now let's hit the Render button and inspect the render results in the frame buffer. Interactive rendering is a great way to get a feel for your render, since it makes it easy to tweak your scene and observe the impact as you work your way to your final image. You'll see how the interactive render gives me very fast feedback with every change we make as we go through this lesson, making it an invaluable tool for my workflow. Alright, as you can see here, we already have light in the project and some materials supplied. The first thing I want to do here is to find the right view of the house, so let's adjust the render camera position a bit until we find a nice perspective. As you can see, everything is updating in the VFB and giving us a very fast preview thanks to the interactive renderer and the speed of V-Ray Next's GPU render engine. Okay, I think this perspective will work. When you're happy with your perspective, you can click on the plus icon or add scene button to add it as a scene in SketchUp. And in the Asset Editor's render output settings, it's also a good idea to make sure you've got Safe Frame toggled on. This way, we'll have a visual cue showing the expected render output area in the viewport. Okay, since I have already saved a scene with this view in advance, I'm going to double-click on it to switch to that scene. Next, I'm not super happy with some of the materials in the scene, so let's see how we can change them. To start, let's take a look at the stucco material, which is applied to the walls of the house. First, let's select the wall geometry, and then let's click on the first category in the Asset Editor up top. This is the Materials category. Here, you can find the materials which are already assigned in the scene, as well as add more. In the search field, let's type stucco. I want to apply the stucco F0150 cm material to the walls. To do so, simply right-click and choose Apply to Selection. Right away, we'll see the material updates in the VFB, thanks to our interactive preview. Next, I want to apply a material to the ground in order to create a more convincing-looking grass, because currently we have only a green color. Let's clear out our search and then expand the left-hand flyout menu. Here, we'll find options to create new assets, as well as a material library with more than 600 ready-to-use materials. If we click the drop-down arrow, you'll see that these are conveniently organized and separated into categories. Since I'd like to create grass, let's head to the ground category and locate the grass E200cm material. Then, let's bring it into our project by clicking and dragging it into the assets list. Now, let's select the grass surface and then right-click on the grass material in our project and choose Apply to Selection. Once again, the interactive preview updates right away to give us a feel for this material in our render. As you can see, the scale of the grass is not correct, but we can easily fix that. In the Material panel in SketchUp, select the Edit tab. Here, we can change the size of the texture in the model. But how do we know what size the material should be? You'll likely have noticed that the materials in VariNext's library all contain measurements in their name. For a grass material, the correct size is 200cm. To set this, we can simply type 200 into the texture size parameter below here. And now, we'll see the correct size for the grass display in the interactive render. Okay, let's go ahead and close the left-hand flyout menu and move on to discuss the lighting. At the top of the asset editor, you'll see that the light bulb icon takes us to the lights category. As you can see, by default we have a sun. It is connected with the shadow system in SketchUp, so we can easily change the time or the date. For example, I'll click to adjust on the time in the shadows panel on the right. Using different sun positions by adjusting the time and date, we can easily affect the mood of our image and explore different looks. Feel free to play with these parameters on your own until you find a light scenario that works well for your composition. I'm going to click on my scene again below, since I have already saved some light settings that I think will work well here. As you can see, this sun position gives me some nice shadows from the trees and adds a sense of depth to the scene. Alright, next, let's move on to explore the geometry category. In the assets list, I already have two V-Ray proxies loaded in, but if we right-click on the Geometry tab, you'll see that there are several specific V-Ray geometries that we can choose from. These include the V-Ray Infinite Plane, proxies for heavier geometry, the V-Ray Clipper, and V-Ray Fur, which can be used to create even more realistic-looking grass. Note that these are the same options as the icons listed in the V-Ray Geometry toolbar above. While the yard surface is still selected, let's go ahead and select the Fur option from the Geometry toolbar. As you can see, the fur appears instantly in the asset editor, and as an added benefit, it takes the material of the source surface. In this case, that would be the grass material we assigned earlier. In the interactive preview, you'll also see that we're starting to get a bunch of grass strands, and the grass is starting to look much more realistic. Now let's select the fur and expand the right-hand flyout menu so that we can tweak it a bit. Here, we can find the fur's settings. Let's change the count to something like 1.2, which will increase the density of the grass strands, making the grass appear more realistic. Keep in mind that the V-Ray fur must be assigned to either a geometry group or geometry component, as the fur will not work if it is assigned to faces. Alright, now let's head to the Render Elements category. Here we can add different render elements, which can be used in the post-production process. Once again, if we right-click, you can see the full list of different render elements that we can choose from. Many of these are useful for masking objects in a post-production workflow. And with the right elements, you can even reconstruct your final image while having the ability to make corrections to each isolated element in the software of your choice. Finally, the fifth category here is for textures. This will list any textures or maps that exist in the project, for example, the sky texture. If we click on it, we could further tweak the sky's appearance and settings to our satisfaction. Okay, let's move on now to discuss the render settings in more detail. Beyond just basic render modes, you'll also find settings for important parameters such as the camera, output resolution, environment, and more. For example, my image appears a bit too dark for my taste, so let's head to the camera rollout. To lighten it up a bit, we can simply tweak the exposure value using the slider. Higher exposure values will make the image darker, whereas lower exposure values make the image brighter. I think somewhere around 13 works pretty well here. The next thing I want to fix in my image here is the perspective. As you'll likely have noticed, the vertical lines do not actually appear perfectly vertical. To fix this, let's head to the effects rollout in the camera settings. Here, we can simply tweak the vertical tilt to correct the perspective. For my project, just a slight increase to around 0.16 works pretty nicely. Now, I'd also like to tweak the aspect ratio of my image in the render output settings. If I click on the aspect ratio dropdown, you'll see a list of different fixed options we can choose from. In this case, I'm going to choose custom and then click on the chain icon to unlock the image width and height parameters so we can adjust them freely. Now I can type in any width and height that I want, for example, 900 by 405, and the aspect ratio will adjust automatically to accommodate the new width and height. I'll also widen the VFB so we can get a full preview of the image with the new width and height. Okay, I think that my image looks about ready now for a final render. So let's stop the interactive render and then switch our settings to production. To do so, simply toggle off the interactive render mode. Then, let's choose a quality setting. For my scene, I think high quality will work fine. Also, I'm going to click on the chain icon to lock the aspect ratio like so. And then let's increase the resolution for our final image to 2000 by 900. All right, once you're happy with your settings, we can start our production render. Now that our render is finished, let's inspect the results. One thing I'm noticing is that the little details in the stucco material are a bit overexposed and blown out where the sun hits, particularly on the left. Since I don't want to have to tweak my lighting and then re-render the entire image to address such a small issue, we can instead fix this using a few color corrections, right inside the VFB. If we click on the small color corrections icon in the bottom left corner of the VFB, we'll open up the color corrections panel. Let's check the box to enable the exposure setting and click on it to drop down the parameters. Here, you can simply lower the highlight burn slider until you see fit. This will selectively apply exposure corrections to the highlights in the image. Just be careful not to overdo this parameter, since at some point, your image can start to look flat. Now, as a final but important step, make sure to click the little floppy disk icon to save the rendered image from the V-Ray frame buffer to your hard drive. All right, as you've seen here, V-Ray Next for SketchUp is efficiently organized to make your workflow straightforward, while giving you intuitive yet powerful controls for quickly getting render results. In addition, you'll find a ton of options for fine-tuning your image directly in V-Ray. All right, let's move on to the next lesson.